It's the day before one of the biggest exams in your life, and you haven't studied at all. Yes, the monkey got you again. But it's okay, you've been paying attention in class, you know what's likely going to be on the test, and you just got feedback from your professor. But for some reason, you decide to accept a challenge with this monkey. To not look at any of that feedback. Any of that personalized feedback that could help you on anything you may have missed out on. And you decide to go into that test blind. Now that may sound stupid, but then why are we doing it with our bodies? Personalized medicine has skyrocketed in the past few years because of the significant decrease to sequence our genome. Genome-wide association studies are happening, and we're finally getting that inside information about us and how that can help with certain diseases. And it's already happening with breast and lung cancer. Precision medicine is making a huge impact in the field of complex diseases. Complex diseases are essentially diseases which have more than one mutation throughout our genome that lead to them. So it's these multiple insertions, deletions, duplications that are leading to these diseases like cancer, diabetes, and even mental illness like schizophrenia. With precision medicine, we're trying to harness all the genomic data that we've collected over the past few years and looking at the certain mutations that happen, which lead to these complex diseases. And then based on that, we can look at mutations in your body so that getting one of these complex diseases doesn't have to be a surprise. But the way we're going about it right now sucks. The current mutation data we're collecting are SNPs, or single nucleotide polymorphisms. And that's where somewhere specifically in the genome, a single nucleobase, so A, C, T, or G, is substituted with another nucleobase. So a simple example of this is in a simple disease in sickle cell anemia, where only one letter is changed to cause this disease. Whereas in complex diseases, there are many SNPs that all contribute to one disease. Polygenic risk scoring is the current approach of taking all our SNPs and looking at which ones play the biggest role in us having a disease in the future. The first step of polygenic risk scoring is all about collecting the data on people and certain SNPs that correlate to certain diseases. But you also have to make choices of what SNPs you feel will most likely be relevant and which will not, because you really don't have time to use every single SNP. After collecting data in the discovery stage, we create a fixed model that can either be weighted or unweighted. Weighted means certain SNPs play a higher role and impact in getting a certain disease, whereas unweighted assumes all SNPs have the same impact. Most of the time, weighted algorithms have better outputs. The weighted algorithm solely functions on adding up SNPs and their contribution to getting a certain disease. Let's say we were assessing somebody's risk for getting diabetes. We would represent our algorithm with an ROC curve, or receiving operator curve. It starts off with a confusion matrix where we essentially plot the predicted and actual results if somebody has diabetes or does not. Then we can plot specific points given the false positive rate and the true positive rate, which are essentially the number of correct versus incorrect guesses. This creates this ROC curve, which is a bit more accurate than regular linear regression models. We can then calculate the area under the curve, or the AUC, given the ROC. The farther to the right you are on this curve, the higher chance you have of developing that disease. Now that the algorithm has been represented, we move on to the second stage of validation, where we take people in a controlled group and see how the algorithm performs on them. But polygenic risk scoring has some major problems. First of all, it can't take in multi-dimension data, so we can't look at effects like the environment, location, ethnicity, or how multiple variants and single nucleotide polymorphisms may play a role to each other. Another thing is we make a lot of assumptions. What SNPs do we want to use? Which ones do we decide to cut out? And both of those factors cause the AUC to have an accuracy of 70%. That sucks. So what's the solution? Well, given a lot of data, you probably guessed it. Machine learning. In the research paper release, it was talked about using either support vector machines or neural networks. Neural networks are something that are coming up more and more in genomics. And surprisingly, they were able to have an AUC accuracy of 99% on diabetic patients, which is absolutely crazy. Essentially, no matter what network you're using, you start by collecting genomic data. This is either given GWAS, genome-wide association studies, or a biobank. This data is then pre-processed, taking out SNPs that are obviously not important. Then we choose our model, in this case, neural networks. Neural networks simply function by having an input layer where they input all the genomic data. This would be certain SNPs, combinations of SNPs, and now you can even add in things like environmental and ethnicity factors. After data is inputted into the input layer, we run it through a hidden layer where weights and biases can be applied. As we train the model more and more, these weights and biases are changed. Weights are essentially numbers you multiply by each input, and biases can be subtracted or added from each node. For example, if we find a certain SNP appears a lot more often with a certain disease, it may have a larger weight because it plays a bigger impact in your chance of getting that disease. Once it's been run through the hidden layer, the output can either give us a value of your chance of having a certain disease or simply if you have that complex disease or not. Machine learning methods are so much better because they can take in multidimensional data. Factors like if you live in a polluted area, if you smoke, what's your eating lifestyle, as well as inheritance, can all play a role in the output. It's absolutely crazy companies like Lumina and 23andMe are backing polygenic risk scoring to go worldwide when its accuracy is so low compared to machine learning. And as we collect more and more data from biobanks and GWAS studies, our data is only going to grow and models are only going to improve. It's even more crazy we haven't looked at our genomic data to assess our risk of getting certain diseases, more so relying on what appears on the outside. But we're still left with the question, why? Why do certain SNPs contribute to certain complex diseases? At the end of the day, we're going to be able to bring precision medicine to a whole new level. Catching diseases like cancer before they start to grow rapidly and being able to apply treatment early on. And hopefully, there will be no more surprises.